as Hollywood Improv and the 3-year anniversary of the Nighttime Show. Our special guests tonight include, from Star Trek Deep Space Nine and Star Trek The Next Generation, Michael Dorn. From Aqua Teen Hunger Force and Squidbillies, Dana Snyder. From NSYNC, you know him, you love him, Joey Fatone. From the greatest 80s movie of all time, Bill Allen. With us as always, our producer, Matt Walker. I'm the voice on the Nighttime Show, Mike Black. We also have Mike Glazer, man of the people. And coming to the stage, the man who ate the people, Stephen Kramer Glickman.
Hey, how we doing, everybody? Good evening, good evening, good evening, good...
A little hot.
Good evening, good... Good evening, and welcome to the Nighttime Show. How we doing, everybody? You feeling good?
Yeah.
Because you're looking good. We've got a wonderful show. Give it up for Mike Black, our amazing announcer. Sex on a stick. Sex on a stick.
It takes quite a few sticks.
What does that even mean?
And then over here, we got the stick man himself, Mr. Matt Walker. Give it up for him.
Am I the stick that Mike is the sex on?
I don't think you can.
I'm a little disturbed.
You can't support this much sex.
Yeah, that's a lot of sex, buddy.
Way too much sex.
Yeah. We got a wonderful show for you guys tonight. I want to give a wonderful shout out to our team helping us put this together. Where's Mike Glazer? Give Mike Glazer a round of applause.
What's up, everybody? How you feeling?
Yeah.
Looking around, wondering where that voice is coming from.
Mike Glazer will be going around the room taking questions from you, the wonderful audience. And have we got a hell of a show for you guys tonight. Wonderful guests from all sorts of different genres. We just got back from LA Comic Con. We just had LA Comic Con.
Yeah. That was a good time.
It was great.
We had an inflatable unicorn. That was very popular.
Yeah, he was very excited about the inflatable unicorn. I was against the inflatable unicorn.
We had an hour-long fight about an inflatable unicorn.
We fought. We're adult men. We're adult men, and we fought about an inflatable unicorn for like 25 minutes.
Yeah. Yeah. I thought it was a terrible idea until a lady dressed up like Pinhead came and sat on it.
Yeah,
that really made it better.
My favorite moment from LA Comic Con is, and this is a stupid moment, but Tommy Wiseau from The Room was there, and I asked him, I said, hey, Tommy Wiseau, would you come into our booth and take a picture in our booth? And he said, yeah, okay, all right, okay. And I was like, come in, just take a seat in this chair and come, we'll take a picture of you. And he sits in the chair and I take a picture. And then I go, hey, can we take another picture of you? And he goes, no, you got your publicity, good for you, guy. And then walked away. So fucking weird. Really lives up to it.
He kept doing, like, I thought he was doing staring contests with me all weekend because he was just a booth away from us just going.
Staring and shaking his head.
Yeah.
This guy wants to play football with me.
And he would throw a football at you and you wouldn't catch it.
Yeah.
It was very uncomfortable.
Hurt.
Well, we've got amazing guests, so we're going to dive right in. Mike, do you want to bring up our first wonderful guest?
Oh, yes, I do. But I wasn't prepared to. There it is. Okay. It's on the first page that I put a lot of soda on. Ladies and gentlemen, our first guest appeared on shows including Chips, 227, Arrow, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, and Castle, but he is best known for appearing in more episodes of Star Trek than anybody in history. Please welcome Worf, son of Mo, Michael Dorn!
Yeah! Da, 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 da. How about this? Michael Dorn, huh?
Yeah.
You freaking kidding me?
Thank you very much.
That's outrageous, sir. It's an outrageous thing that you're here. We're such huge fans of you. And of your entire career, where did you grow up, Michael? Where are you originally from?
I grew up in Pasadena, California.
Oh, wow.
Yes.
Oh, wow. Mm-hmm. Right around the corner.
I moved for 3 years in San Francisco, which I don't remember. I know there was a whip and a midget, and that's all I can remember.
Sure.
But and then I moved back and got in the business, and that was it.
Wow.
Yeah.
What was your first acting job? Do you remember what your first acting job was?
Yeah, it wasn't an acting job at first, but it turned into one. Is that in the first Rocky movie?
What? Which? Wow. What did you play in the first Rocky movie?
I played Apollo Creed's bodyguard.
Oh my God! How did you get cast?
Very quick. I mean, yeah. It's like one of those quick scenes, you know?
Yeah.
To be clear, the first movie, not the one where he died.
The first one.
You were a successful bodyguard.
Yeah, the first one. Yeah, it was really interesting. It's sort of like, you know, the way my career is. I was hired for like 3 or 4 days, and they said, hey, you know, we really want you to stay around to do this and do this. And so it was amazing. In fact, I saw Stallone not too long ago, and I told him about the story. And he had a great story, too, is that nobody wanted the Rocky movie. When they were filming it, they didn't want him. They liked the script, but they didn't want him. And when people say they were, you know, we're going to pull the plug on this thing,
right?
He wanted to do a scene where he had to be drunk, and he said, "This is very important to the scene. I got to do it again." And they said no, and they kept fighting back and forth. And they said, "You have one take," and they had a guy actually at the generator, ready to pull the plug.
Oh my God.
If they went over,
wow!
And it was a thing. Nobody wanted that movie. So and here we are, you know, 50,000 years later. And they,
yeah, right.
And
yeah,
he just sounded just drunk through the whole movie.
Yeah, it's just amazing. It's just amazing. Yeah.
We've got lots of shows that we have to cover, we should play a clip. Do you want to play some clip or stuff, or do you want to talk?
Yeah, we'll do it when we get to the stuff.
All right, fine. Go ahead.
So you did a lot of acting work in the 80s on various shows. You were on Chips for 80 episodes or so?
Yeah.
How did you wind up on that show? I mean, was it like just going for a normal audition process?
Yeah, just another audition. And another interesting story. The guy, I went in and they said, hey, Mike, we like you, but we're going to hire this other guy, who was Jane Kennedy's husband, Leon Isaac Kennedy. Mm-hmm. And they hired him. And they said, look, you know, if he doesn't work out, we'll give you a call, which is like, you know, don't call us, we'll call you. And, you know, about 2 weeks later, I get a call. And they said, would you come back? And so I said, sure. And I read and got the part. But what happened is that he told them he could ride a motorcycle. And obviously, he couldn't. And so...
Yeah, that's not one you want to lie about.
That's not the one you want to lie about.
Yeah, you can lie about a lot of stuff when you're auditioning, but that's not one of them.
So that's what happened. I mean, it was 3 years, but man, it was an amazing time.
Did you do any of your own stunts like for that show? Like,
oh, no. No. I mean, I drove fast, but that's about it. I mean, it was a stunt-driven show.
Yeah.
So they had guys that were doing all that stuff, and it was pretty crazy.
Yeah, and then you were on a guest star on a lot of sitcoms, and I actually watch a lot of old sitcoms, and I've seen you recently on episodes of both 227 and Give Me a Break.
Come on, Nell Carter. You kidding me? That's amazing.
Yeah. Yep.
Well, yeah? Is that a good thing?
Did you enjoy your time on those shows?
Well, you know, it's just the idea that when I started then, you know, doing all this stuff, I always played, you know, boyfriends, mm-hmm. you know, who never got the girl, and you know, doctors, and you know, and oh well, you know, your husband died. I'm so sorry. You know, I mean, it was, and it just was crazy. It just was one of those things where I got a little tired of it after a while, mm-hmm. because you would always come in, and there was jokes would fly, but I enjoyed it. I mean, I love sitcoms, mm-hmm. and they were great, and. Thelma Hopkins, who was on 227, not 227, but Give Me a Break, was a dear friend of mine for many years. Wow. Still is, I mean. Mm-hmm.
So then late 80s happens, you audition for Star Trek.
Yep.
And Worf was sort of an afterthought to the show, is that right?
Yes. I had heard that they were doing Next Generation. So I called my agent and manager. I said, hey, look, you know, you got to get me an audition. And they called back and said, no, you know, it's already cast. Once again, we'll call you. You know?
Right, yeah.
And 2 weeks later, I get a call, and my agent says, Michael, they want to see you for a part of a Klingon. And she says, what's a Klingon? And I said, well, it's this, and explained it to her. And it was, like you said, it was just an afterthought. In fact, I read, all the other actors had gone through 3 months of auditions, and I had like 2 days.
Oh my God.
They narrowed it down from 20 guys to 3 guys, and then they said, oh, you got the job, go into makeup that day.
Wow.
And then within about 3 or 4 days, I was on the set working.
Wow.
So yeah, so it was pretty fast.
And how long is that makeup process? Like every day for 12 years, basically, or whatever?
It started out to be 3 hours a day.
Wow.
And well, Next Generation, it was every day.
Now, have you been in makeup more than anyone else? It feels like that.
Anyone else in life.
I think in history,
probably been in makeup.
To be in prosthetics for more than anyone else.
I think I think it's 1,000 makeups that I did, something like that.
Oh my God.
I think it's 1,000 is what we came.
That's an insane amount of time.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh my God.
But it was, you know, while you're doing it, it doesn't really feel like that because you're happy to be working.
Can I tell you, I wore one of those fake mustaches on Halloween. With the in removing the spirit gum that day, I was like, never ever again. Yeah. You did it 1,000 times.
1,000 times,
your whole
head.
Oh my God.
Yeah. But it was, you know, when you get the job, like most of us, you get the job and it's your first real series or whatever the case, and you're just happy to be there. So
right,
you just kind of you know, deal with it.
Well, let's watch a okay. clip.
Oh let's yeah, watch let's watch a clip. Real quick.
Can we show a clip for God's sake?
For God's sake, please.
I am Worf.
Turn it up.
Son of Mog.
Let's turn the lights down just a little.
I have much to teach you about women. That is how the Klingon lures a mate.
Are you telling me to go yell at Selene?
No. Men do not roar. Women roar. And they hurl heavy objects. And claw at you.
What does the man do?
He reads love poetry. He ducks a lot. Klingons do not pursue relationships. They conquer that which they desire.
Oh, yes.
Knife planet. You are fully dilated to 10 centimeters. You may now give birth. Sir, I protest. I am not a married man.
How amazing is that? It's just amazing. It's great to just. It's so amazing. It's so great to look back, though. Is it? What does it feel like for you to look back? Is it feel weird?
No, it's horrible.
Really? Oh, come on.
It was so long ago.
Oh my God.
It was so long ago, and you know, sometimes you kind of look at it and you go. Wow, what was I doing? You know, who was
it's
this guy?
Such a
you know?
Fascinating character, though.
Did
like,
you know, like when you're filming character. These scenes, that you were the funny part most of the time?
No. In fact, he was never slated to be the funny part, and they didn't really think about him like that until that scene, Nice Planet.
Yeah,
it was the first season, and that's when they started. The producer said they ran that over, and for some reason they thought it was the funniest thing they've ever seen.
Yeah,
and I was just, you know, it was just
the line.
Just the line, you know?
Yeah.
And so they started writing a Worf line every year. Mm-hmm. It was like they all got together and they would save up, you know, for their Worf line. And so and that's how it started. But
well, it definitely paid off because it's such a beloved character too.
Well, the whole idea why he is like that is that he doesn't think he's funny.
Yeah.
And so he's not trying to be funny. And so that's what makes him, you know, hilarious.
So on an ensemble show like that, like as a fan, when you watch, you're like, oh, this is a Data episode, this is a Worf episode, mm-hmm. this is a Troy episode. Like, would the writers come to you at some point and be like, hey, next week we've got a Worf episode, get ready, we're going to do a bunch of Klingon stuff? No.
They actually, we really didn't see it until we got the script. Mm-hmm. And then they said, and occasionally they would say, hey, how do you feel about this? You know, or There was one writer, Ron Moore, who wrote a bunch of Klingon episodes, really wonderful writer and producer. And I could tell that he was going to write a Worf show because he grew a Worf beard. And you see him walking. I said, it's a Worf episode. He says, oh, yeah, you know. And so it was it was one of those things where it just wasn't, you know, we just didn't know. Occasionally they would ask you how you felt about something. But for me, it was always, you know, wouldn't it be funny if Worf is the line that they always said. You know, wouldn't it be cute if Worf? And you knew that you were going to be doing something, you know, fairly stupid.
Yeah.
You know, for a Klingon.
Well, and poor Worf only won like one hand of poker in 7 seasons on Star Trek.
Yeah, exactly. You know, so.
Yeah. Now, you actually were in Star Trek VI, The Undiscovered Country. You got to play Worf's grandfather. You got to play your own grandfather.
Uh-oh. You guys know what that means. That sound means nerd alert.
What is that? What is that?
Matt Walker has become frustrated.
He just got too nerdy. We just hit the level of too nerdy. We are now in the nerd zone. That means we have to put a 3-minute clock up on the time. There we go. 3-minute timer.
3 minutes.
Matt, you got 3 minutes to ask all the nerdiest questions. Michael, you have to answer quickly to these questions. You got to answer quick.
You didn't tell me about this.
It's going to happen. And then maybe Matt, you can beat your last time when you interviewed.
We got 7 questions to Walter Koenig in 3 minutes.
Yeah, from Star Trek.
There we go.
The original series. All right, here we go. Ready and begin.
Okay, who was a better brother of Worf? Was it Tony Todd as Kern or Paul Sorvino as Nikolai Roshenko?
Tony Todd.
Okay.
Good. Is that right?
I think yes. Correct answer.
It's great. You decide whether they're right or not.
Which is a better episode? Is it Redemption or Parallels?
Oh, Redemption.
Oh, wow. I'd go Parallels. That's my personal favorite Worf episode.
You're running out of time,
Matt. Come on.
Best mate for Worf. Was it Kyler, Deanna Troi, Jadzia Dax, or Ezri Dax?
Jadzia.
Yeah. Great. That's the one you married. Gotta go with Jadzia.
Very well done. Well
done. How many words of Klingon can you speak?
2.
What are they?
Nook Nech.
And what does that mean?
Oh, don't you know?
I'm not a Klingon speaker.
It means what do you want?
Oh. Well, I will say Qapla. That's what I know.
That's down the hall to the left.
It's a very important one to know. Yes.
Very important.
Keep going.
Best guest star, John DeLancey or Jeffrey Combs?
Got to be John DeLancey. Jeffrey Combs.
Okay.
Ooh. Yeah, John DeLancey's great.
Last minute twist there.
Well, because Jeffrey Combs played both Liquidator Brunt, he played Wayoon.
Oh my God, you're running out of time, Matt. Yeah, Come on! We're at 5 questions!
Okay.
Close to your record.
Was Worf a deadbeat dad to Alexander?
Yes.
Yeah.
6.
I think that's accurate, yes.
Big time deadbeat.
Okay, in the episode Justice, would the Enterprise have been better off in the long run by just letting the people of Edo execute Wesley Crusher?
Yes, I think so.
That is the right answer.
Actually, I think
they should have executed everybody on that planet. That was one of the worst.
In the movie Ted 2, you dressed in a bad Worf costume and went to Comic-Con. Have you ever done anything like that in real life?
No.
Okay. Would you do anything like that in real life?
No.
Okay. Who was a better baseball player, Worf on the Deep Space Niners or Willie Hawkins in the Far Beyond the Stars episode?
Willie Hawkins.
Yeah.
Worf was terrible.
We're at 10.
New York Giants.
We're at 10.
What is the strangest gift you've been given by a fan?
That's a tough question. Pot brownies.
Very nice. Very nice. Last question.
Oh, okay. Which was a better 80s crossover Star Trek episode, Reading Rainbow or Webster?
The look on his face says so much.
Reading Rainbow.
Yeah, that's 11! 11 questions! We beat it! Come on, big round of applause! Oh my God! Whew, I didn't think we were going to do it.
Yeah.
didn't think we were going to do
it.
I
think the audience has some questions now.
The audience has questions. Yeah, we got a question on the there. Mike Glazer, take it to the audience.
Absolutely. Your hands were raised over here. Also, thank you for taking those pot brownies. I do appreciate it.
Yeah, that was a Deep Space Nine episode, absolutely. Since you are essentially the Frasier of sci-fi, do you
Thank
ever?
You. Thank
yeah,
you
yeah.
Very
well, I mean, yeah, think I about it. You are the Frasier of sci-fi. Yeah. Do you ever call up at times and start making fun of your other cast members, saying, "I got two checks this month in residuals. What'd you get?"
No, because there's always somebody that's making more money than me. There's always somebody. No,
I love it. We got another question up,
right up front.
Question up front. Question up front. This guy here.
Here you go.
Howdy.
Hi.
So of all the productions that you've worked on, what was your favorite crew to work with?
Ooh, that's a good question.
Of all the productions ever? Yeah.
Your favorite group of people.
Yeah, best team.
I think Deep Space was. I mean, I was with them for 4 years, and we had a lot of fun. We laughed. I laughed more with the crew than with the actors. I mean, we just had a blast. You know, making up stuff. I mean, they had a thing with me where I'd always say, "Okay, where's my light? You know, where's my show me where my light is," and they would always have something rigged that was just ridiculous. You know, like they had a big light on one time, and I go, "Where's my light?" And the guy reaches over and turns it off and goes, "There it is." I mean, just on and on. But actually, I did 5 episodes of Castle, and that was a fantastic job. I really enjoyed that as a psychiatrist. So
yeah. Such a great show.
But any more questions?
Any more questions? Who do we got?
Got hands up?
Raise it up. Raise it up.
I've got one, but also I wanted to make sure everyone has time to ask them. I'd like to hear more about you as a pilot also.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
It's pretty spectacular.
Yeah, I've always wanted to fly since I was a kid,
yeah.
You know, since I was, you know, 2 and 3 years old. And it's 1988, there was a writer's strike. So we had 4 months, 5 months of doing nothing. And so I had talked about learning to fly for years and years. And so I finally did. I went down to Santa Monica, learned how to fly. And what happened was that was all great. And you know, worked out really well and met some great people. And but they called me one day and they said, "Hey, look, you know, this producer said Woody Harrelson, who was on Cheers, couldn't go and fly with the military. Would you like to go?" And I said, "Sure. What are they?" And he said, the Blue Angels."
Oh my God!
Wow.
Yeah. And I went, "Okay." Yeah. And so I went down there and flew with the Blue Angels. And it was fantastic, you know. I was doing all the stuff, and it was, and because that whole military aviation is such a small community, they said, "Hey, you know, he's a pilot, and he's on Star Trek, and the military loves Star Trek." And so I started getting invited to all these things, and they'd say, it would always start the same way. My manager would call me, and she goes, "Michael, the guys from the Okies, which is the Air National Guard unit, they called, and they said, they'd love for you to come out and hang out with the troops and sign autographs and, you know, make it a weekend." I said, "Sure." And they said, "They can't pay you, but they'll give you a ride in something."
Right.
And I go, "Okay, what do they got?" And they said, "Well, F-16s.
Ooh.
Okay. And I'd go out there and I would go out 4 airplanes and we'd dogfight in F-16s.
Oh, my God.
Air-to-air refueling. And this went on, you know, F-18s and, you know, with the Canadians. And then I went with the Thunderbirds. We flew over the Golden Gate Bridge in an F-16.
So cool. Wow.
And the guy said that they had to cut out part of the video because they have a video that they give to all the people that you fly. And I said, "Why'd you do that?" He says, "Because I thought you were having an orgasm back there."
Oh, my God.
And I went, "So?" But it was
just
like,
for me.
They were flying around. I was in the backseat going, "Oh, yes, yes, yes." And it was,
oh my God.
And and then the end of it,
that would
the
be
last
good psychological warfare against that would be a little bit. Pilots.
And the last thing I did for them was, and in the meantime, I've owned and bought and sold many, many airplanes over the years. And the last thing was, they said, would you like to go on an aircraft carrier in an F-18? I said, yes. And we went out off the coast of San Diego and did like trap shots, just like in Top Gun, you know, mm-hmm. just round and round. And it was pretty wild.
Wow. That's so amazing.
Yeah, it was a great career.
No, well, another quick question for you now. Yeah. I want to hear you tell us about the Worf Chronicles, because I've seen you tweeting about it and things. So please tell us about the Worf Chronicles.
Yeah, I wrote a script back in 2012 because I thought that I was done with, you know, I thought I was. But then I said, I think this Worf character has a little more life. So I wrote a script. And as they say in the business, it got a little traction occasionally, but nothing came out of it. But it's basically the continuing adventures of Worf. He's not a captain of a starship, but he's gone back to the Empire to hold it together. Mm-hmm. And it's very Shakespearean. It has a lot of coups, a lot of assassinations, a lot of takeovers. And so we're hoping with this new resurgence on CBS that that it has a place. So we'll see what happens.
And have they contacted you about the Picard show that they've got? Have you been in touch with them at all?
No. It's I think it's just going to be Picard. You know, in a room.
Yeah, just alone. Just alone.
You know, talking about his life. Yes, well, the other day I took a shower and it was, you know, it was warm and I felt good, you know. And that's going to be the show.
That'll be the whole show. I love it. Well, we have a very special thing. Matt, would you like to take it?
I will do the presentation.
Let's play some music, please. Some music. We would like to present you with an award, Michael, as the greatest actor in the universe. We had this trophy that we made present to you with a Golden Globe for the greatest actor in the history of the universe.
I'd like to thank the Academy of Bad Comedians for, and I will give this award its due based on the way it's put together.
Matt worked really hard on this.
He really did.
I see he did.
It's like, used a lot of glue.
You forgot there's holes still.
Right, there's still some holes in there.
Oh boy!
To end this wonderful interview, Matt Walker found something really incredible, and we'd love to play it.
Do I have to stay here?
No, you can take off. But I will walk. I will walk you out, ladies and gentlemen. Michael Dorn, the greatest, and ladies and gentlemen, Worf on a little show called Webster. Let's watch that.
Here we go.
Identify yourself. How did you come aboard the Starship Enterprise?
All I know is I pushed my joystick too far forward. Maybe I should have gotten that extended warranty.
You look like an Earthling. but your style of dress is puzzling.
Oh, thanks. I kind of like to stay one step ahead of the fashion. No one else will be wearing this until 1990.
That was more than 300 years ago. You're in the 24th century.
No way, Jose.
The intruder is unarmed, Lieutenant Worf.
Man, this is really cool.
Cool? The temperature on the Enterprise never varies.
No! Red, cool, blazing!
That is a language I do not understand. There are many things about your time I do not understand, such as your customs.
Like what?
Your social customs, like mud wrestling, Groundhog Day, dancing for fun.
Well, I didn't get the first two either, but dancing is the greatest.
In many parts of this galaxy, it's considered a prelude to violence.
No, come on, look.
Told you.
Come on, man, cool it. Look, let me explain it this way. See, I have an Uncle Philip, and he's a dancer. And he's pretty good. Plus, I'm not bad myself.
All right, we can cut that. How awesome is that, though? Come on. A great find from the mysterious Matt Walker.